Good morning. Welcome to worship on this fresh Sunday morning. So glad that you are all here with us this morning. Please, in these few moments of gathering, take a moment to circulate our welcome pad so that each one of us might register our presence. We will have a time during worship for sharing of joys and concerns. So if you've brought a special prayer request on your heart this morning, please also take a moment to write out your prayer card, and those may simply be passed to the center aisle. Our ushers will collect those during the opening hymn. After worship, there's a number of displays with information on ministries that may be of interest to you. We host a week of the men's homeless shelter beginning in February, and those sign-up sheets are available. You'll see that we are again collecting winter outerwear for our neighborhood students at Jackson Elementary. Our confirmation students are taking orders for wrap sandwiches and sub sandwiches to be made fresh for your Super Bowl Sunday. Cargill apparel is available in Fellowship Hall this morning. And two special invitations. There'll be an information meeting this morning at 11:40 for our youth work mission trips this summer, for anybody interested in that. And we will again be celebrating prayers from the heart throughout the month of February. As you leave worship this morning, at each of the usher stations are manila envelopes that are identified family of one, that means one child, family of two, two children, and you're invited to take an envelope and then to pay special attention to that child or those children with your prayers or a postcard or a contact throughout the month of February so that each of our children feel that connection with the larger church. Also this morning, we participate in the annual Human Relations Day special offering. With United Methodist congregations all across the United States, we are raising funds for community organizers, for help for at-risk youth through the youth offender rehabilitation programs, community development, and work with at-risk teens. So I commend that to you as well this morning. But we continue in this holy season of Epiphany, a season of God's self-revealing. God who always reveals God's self as light in the darkness, as spirit and wholeness in the midst of our brokenness, as life and love in the midst of our life's challenges. So we've celebrated the star and the wise men and the dove coming at Jesus' baptism. And this morning, God speaking through the powerful witness of John the Baptist, welcome. Welcome to worship.
Thank you. Would you please stand if you're comfortable and join with me in the opening prayer? Steadfast God, you have enriched and enlightened us by the revelation of your eternal Christ. Comfort us in our mortality and strengthen us to walk on the path which you illuminate, so that our lives may be steadfast the every gift of your faithfulness and love. Amen.
Great joy, we celebrate the blessing of the sacrament of holy baptism this morning, and I'd like to invite our family and sponsors to please come forward. You should be at the end. Our parents and sponsors. And if you'll be closer to Pastor Sonmin, and if the sponsors parents would come here, please. Sponsors over here, please. We can come this way a little bit, so we're not so.
Yeah, so people can see the prompt. Yeah, up there.
Yeah. We're just going to stand in a line back here a little bit so that we can see the font. Thank you. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of holy baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. And all this is God's good gift offered to us without price. Oh, our Lord has expressly given to little children a place among the people of God, which privilege must not be denied them. We remember when Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God." What name is given this child? Today, Anastasia and Alexander Pine, along with their sponsors, Laura Shaw and Taylor Pine, bring James Anders to celebrate God's claim on his life.
On behalf of Christ's Holy Church and this congregation, I ask you, do you profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? If so, please respond, we will. We do. Will you accept as your responsibility and privilege to live your life so James will, by your example and influence, seek to follow in the faith? If so, please respond, we will. Will you promise, as God gives you wisdom, to raise and nurture James in the Christian faith, bringing him to services of worship, making it possible for him to take part in religious education, and in ways open to you, help him to grow in faith and love of God? If so, please respond, we will. As a congregation, let us respond together. With God's help,
we will proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround James Anders with a community of love and forgiveness that he may grow in service to others. We will pray for James Anders that he may be a true disciple who walks in the way that leads to life. We're going to invite our sponsors, if you would kindly pour the water into the font for us.
We baptize by water in the
Holy Spirit. Gracious God, pour out your Spirit to bless this gift of water and he who receives it, to wash away his sin and clothe him in righteousness throughout his life, that dying and being raised with Christ, he may share in Christ's final victory. Amen.
Can I work with the James? Come here. Yes. Yeah. James Anders, I baptize you in the name of the Father, of the Son, of the Holy Spirit. Amen. I invite parents and sponsors closer.
Come closer. Lay your hands
to
on the
baby. Please lay your hands on this child. For the congregation, I invite you to extend your hands to this child.
Raise your hand.
For blessing, the Holy Spirit work within you. That being born water through water and the Spirit, you may be a child of God, the faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
This is James Anderson Pye, the very newest member of Christ's Holy Church. Amen.
Let us pray. O God, grant that this child, as he grows in years, may also grow in grace and in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. By the power of the Holy Spirit, may this child be a true child of yours, faithfully serving you all of his days. So guide and uphold his parents and sponsors, that by loving care, wise counsel, and holy example, they may lead him into the life of faith, whose strength is righteousness, and whose fruit is everlasting joy and peace. Now may God, our Creator, Christ our Savior, and the presence of the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
We have some gifts to present. There is a read-along Bible to help you with your vows of introducing the faith to James, a copy of his certificate, and the service that we shared this morning, and the seashell that was inside of the font, as we remember that God brings life from the waters and God continues to create and blessed life. Then we have a special presentation from our Goshen quilters.
Goshen quilters have created an I-Spy quilt. Each little piece in there is a different character or interest. And as James grows, he'll be able to play with these different things. And on the back are vehicles.
Oh, will you join me as we sing our blessing to James? Congratulations. Thank you so much. Blessings to you. Thank you so much. Congratulations. Blessings on your beautiful boy. Congratulations on your big day. Thank you, Sonia. Certainly at the top. Thank you.
This morning's gospel lesson is found in John 1:29 through 42. You can follow along in the Pew Bible found on page 70 of the New Testament. It is a story of John the Baptist meeting for the first time as an adult with Jesus Christ. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John testified, 'I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, "He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And myself I have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God." The next morning, John again was standing with two of his disciples as they watched Jesus walk by. He exclaimed, "Look, here is the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, "What are you looking for?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which translated means teacher, "where are you staying?" He said to them, "Come and see." They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4:00 in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and follow him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, "You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas," which is translated Peter. Praise God for this reading from his holy word. Thanks be to God.
earlier this morning, it looked like we were going to be here by our little selves, Pastor Songman and I and Brian. It takes something to get out on a cold morning like this, doesn't it? I mean, it's cold, it's windy, we've been out clearing snow, and really we were all just here for Christmas. And those decorations have all been put away, and probably the needles in the carpeting are just about worked themselves out, right, and been all vacuumed up. And yet, here we are. We come because there's something in us seeking, longing for this connection. And as we heard the scriptures read so beautifully this morning, and we hear Jesus saying to those two disciples, "What are you looking for?" Sometimes our spirits bring us and lead us, even if we can't quite name exactly what it is we're looking for. It's probably not one more thing to do this week. Our calendars are full. We get in the car when we need to get someplace quickly because we need to be someplace immediately after that. I had this memory of my grandparents going for a Sunday afternoon drives. And I can't remember the last time I got in the car when I didn't have to be someplace and I had it timed like to the minute. Our calendars are full, our lives are full. My business card has about 100 ways that you can contact me. My church phone and my home phone and my cell phone and my home email and my church email, and there's a fax machine and there's a full. And yet, there's still room in our lives. There still is this longing that some theologians have spoken of or described as a hole that only Christ can fill, a God-shaped space in our spirits, in our persons, in our longings, in our lives. And our culture continues to look for this kind of meaning. During the course of Jesus' ministry, it became clear that people were looking for all kinds of things from him. As his reputation spread, as word traveled of his life and his teachings and the people that he had touched, there were throngs that crowded around him with every kind of disease and ailment and illness, and they were looking for healing. As his popularity spread, there were religious authorities who questioned his theology, his orthodoxy, his intention. They were looking for a fight that would escalate throughout his public ministry. As his miracles took shape, crowds came, not even sure why they were there. Maybe they were looking for entertainment. Some sought depth of meaning. He touched something in them, like the rich young ruler. Others looking for a way to heaven. And in the famine times, when poverty and hunger robbed the energy and the life from the people, they came looking for loaves and fishes. And when our Lord went off by himself on the mountain to become lost in prayer, the disciples came running, declaring, "Lord, everyone is looking for you. Everyone is looking for you." The disciples were right. Everyone, all people are looking for the living Spirit of God, for the love of God in Jesus Christ, for this connection to the divine from which we've come, who is the creator and the source of our lives, the center of our beings. Even if we don't always realize it, each of us has this place in our hearts, in our spirit, that only Christ can fill. The two disciples, now remember, these are disciples of John. This is before Jesus has ever spoken publicly. There have been no miracles. He's spoken to no one. No one knows anything about this man, but these disciples of John have heard John's witness. Behold the Lamb of God. This is the Messiah. This is the one who comes to take away the sin of the world, this collective brokenness in which we find ourselves in our separation from God. But this is the one. This is the power of God among us. And as Jesus walks by and John makes this proclamation, they follow at a distance. I love, as I read the stories of the Bible, to ask, why did John tell this part? Or why was this important? Or why did he tell it in this manner? But I see the two disciples follow Jesus at a distance. And I thought, isn't that how a lot of us began our journeys in faith? Kind of at a distance, you know, sitting in the pew thinking, what do I think about this? Or watching people of deep faith. What do they have? How do they live? Kind of at a distance, observing. But of course, we don't learn that much from a distance. And Jesus, sensing their presence, turns around and asks very directly, what are you looking for? What are you looking for? Their answer, I wonder if they'd given it much thought or if it was what they could think of. Where are you staying? Now, that has a depth of meaning. We have to assume that in John. Everything in John has layers and layers of meaning. Where are you staying? Where can we kneel at your feet to hear? Where is your grounding? From where do you come? Where is the strength and this power and this glory to which John has witnessed? Where are you staying? And Jesus answers with the powerful words, come and see. Come and see. Come and experience. God is still speaking. Come and see all that will come from this. Behold the Lamb of God, John proclaims. As I offered in our prayer earlier this morning, we trust, don't we? We trust the active presence of God. We trust God's compassion and God's mercy, that we are not alone in this world. But sometimes in my own life, and as I am privileged to walk with other people in their lives, the problems loom large. The challenges that roll in can feel overwhelming. And we may feel as if we don't know how to proceed. We don't know how to get through this time of loss or of challenge or of change. And I wonder if we don't forget that the promise is also the God from the God of the universe. As John said, he who comes after me is more powerful than I because he came before, present at the creation of the world and the universe, this Christ. We need also the Christ who calms the winds and the waves, who speaks and creation obeys, who raises life out of death, who brings wholeness in the midst of brokenness, who could take the most humbled, broken person and lift them into all the glory of heaven that God intended. And this is the one who takes away the sin of the world. This majesty and power and this divine mercy. Come and see, Jesus tells us. And you've witnessed to me, and I can witness to you, that those times in my life when my Christ was too small, I limited his power to work in my life. We need to claim all of this. Behold the Lamb. Behold the Majesty. I found a beautiful story. In a cathedral in Copenhagen, Denmark, there is a simply magnificent sculpture of Christ. The sculptor is Bertel Thorvaldsen. And his vision was the Christ that he prayed to and that he related to was the victorious Christ. This Christ in clay has a face upturned toward the heavens with an expression of victory, the arms stretched out wide in power and in light. He finished the sculpture and he gave thanks to God for its beauty, the majestic, conquering Christ. But later that night, when he had gone home and closed up his studio, the sea mist came in through the windows and under the doors, and the clay, which was not yet hardened, absorbed the moisture. And as he came into the studio the next morning, he was dismayed and distraught and disappointed that the head had come down and that the arms raised in victory were now stretched out, almost in invitation. But as Thorvaldsen fell to his knees, he saw the Christ he had never known, the Christ he had never met. And he entitled the sculpture, "Come Unto Me." It has inspired millions of people over the years. This witness of John the Baptist to the power and love of God in the person of Christ, because God so loved the world that God gave his only Son from the creation of the universe all the power and the glory of God, and this compassionate, intimate connections. There are many things we can learn from this story, but over and over again we hear the power of Jesus' own words, "Come and see." He's saying, "Come and see." And to us today, those words are spoken the same. You know, it's a brand new year. Pick up that Bible that's in your dining room. Or if you don't have one, we give them away. There's some on the back center. And if you really like the one in the pew, go ahead and take that. We want people to read. And just start in Matthew. Come and see. Read about Jesus' life, what he taught, what he said. It'll bring comfort and strength. It'll make you uncomfortable and stir your spirit. Come and see the people he loved. Over and over again, the outcast and the disenfranchised and the marginalized. Come and see how lives were changed. Come and see, learn the things that he did. What happened when people met him and let him enter their lives? Come and see, Jesus speaks. He's talking about a personal relationship. It's easier to follow at a distance. Who is God, and what do I think of God, and what do I think I believe? And I hear this from young people often. Well, I'm just not sure what I believe yet, when before I'm ready to come to worship or before I'm ready to make a commitment. I want to know what I think, and I want it all to make sense, and I want to know. But Jesus says, come. Come and see. He's speaking about a personal relationship, a God that's beyond theology, a God who longs to be in intimate relationship with you, who knows your heart and your life and your challenges and your joys, who wants to be your strength and your grace and your forgiveness and the mercy and the love that you want so long to share with your family and your friends and with your neighbors. Come and see. A number of years ago, our youth were wearing WWJD bracelets. What would Jesus do? I always wanted to add a few more letters. What would Jesus want me to do? In my relationship with God, in my commitment to Christ, how is using my life, me, my specific skills, and how I've been hurt, and how I've been wounded, and how I've been educated and loved, and what I have to offer, what does Jesus want of me? And what does God want to give me? And how is God going to work through even my most humble life? The stories of Jesus' life are rich and varied because he reached out to so many different people. And they all had a different name for him. And they were all looking for something different. And yet he is all of the power of heaven and all of the mercy for every individual heart. We begin this journey over and over again, and each time God reveals God's self, always as light for our darkness, always as strength in our weakness, always as hope and promise in the midst of a world broken. Come and see, God is still speaking. Christ is still speaking. The Spirit is still moving. In this holy season of Epiphany, we delight. We are keeping the stars lit on our altar table. We enter into this new year with this anticipation. And our Lord turns and looks at us. What are you looking for? And then bids us to follow and goes just ahead into every challenge and every joy. Come and see. Alleluia and Amen.
When Andrew found Jesus, the Messiah, he immediately wanted to share the good news of Jesus Christ with his brother, Simon. In the same way, we wanted to share the good news of Jesus Christ with one another and with the world around us and our gifts today. One way we shared the good news with others. Let us give our offerings to God.
Please join with me in the prayer of dedication. God of grace and glory, you call us to be your people, faithful and courageous, as your beloved Son embraced his mission in the waters of baptism Inspire us to join in his transforming work. Receive these gifts along with our hearts and use them to proclaim the healing power of the gospel by acts of love in your name. Amen.
So we go forth to be the church. Know that you carry with you all of this love of God, this peace of Christ, and the encouragement, the empowerment of the Holy Spirit through every trial and in all rejoicing. Alleluia and Amen. Amen.